delivered in Williamsburg before the revolution? Is life so dear and peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God. I care not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. As I accompanied my mother and father on marches, we would sing, oh freedom, before I be a slave, I'll be buried in my grave and go home to my Lord to be free. When I was in my early 20s, my favorite book was How I Found Freedom in an Unfree World. Freedom. I was born in an era that longed for freedom. Freedom to eat where we wanted, freedom to go to the schools that we wanted, freedom not to have to twist ourselves into brown versions of glossy images of feminine likeness, freedom not to be bound by societal norms of respectability, freedom to say what we wanted, freedom from the biological constraints of birthing. Freedom from rods and girders. We just wanted to be free. For me, and I think for others as well, beneath all that yearning for freedom was wanting to be free enough to change the world, to make the world a better place. One protest, one sit-in, one song, one bra burning at a time. It was a time of wanting to break free of so many constraints, social, political, religious, and cultural. In fact, the reason that I belong to the United Church of Christ today is because I felt this denomination stood in a legacy and also yearned for freedom. Because it was the Congregationalists who were free enough to defend those Africans who revolted on that slave ship, the Amistad, headed for Cuba, and ended up in New England. And it was the Congregationalists who paid John Quincy Adams to defend them and set them free. It was the UCC who was free enough in their theological thinking to stand with Cesar Chavez, to stand with the Wilmington 10, to stand with Dr. King. In fact, this denomination wanted to be free so much, each church under its umbrella has local autonomy. There was no one on high to dictate to them. They could rule and manage themselves within their own cultural context. They had the freedom to go along with the recommendations of the denominations or not. They could follow the prescribed order of worship or not. They were free to govern and worship as they saw fit. But you know what? America has interpreted this notion of freedom in negative ways as well. For as Americans, we have had the freedom to enslave, the freedom to exploit, the freedom to incarcerate, the freedom to detain, the freedom to murder, the freedom to destroy anything we define as American. This cliche of freedom in American political rhetoric makes it very difficult to distinguish what kind of freedom are you talking about. I think that many people don't really understand freedom. Most people think freedom means you can do just whatever you want to do. But if you think about the parable of the prodigal son, that's how he defined freedom. Thought that getting an easy inheritance and getting all the money and he could do what he want, indulging in instant gratification, that was freedom for him. But soon he found that that freedom enslaved him. I believe the true definition of freedom is being able to be all that you were meant to be. Don't you long for that? a co-creator with the Holy. So in today's text, we hear the well-known passage, "The truth shall make you free." So what kind of freedom is Jesus talking about? Well, this fourth gospel seems to support that liberation theology, if you will, for this vision of freedom illustrated through various narratives depicts the liberation of individuals and groups marginalized in first century Jewish society. The hungry, the ill, the physically impaired, they are liberated from their adverse circumstances by the restorative powers of Jesus. But here in today's reading, Jesus' mention of freedom offends his audience, who insists they've always been slaves. Even though, as he's talking to his audience, they are living as colonized people under Roman occupation. And Jesus contends without him, they are slaves. Now, his ancient audience is upset because to say that Jesus brings freedom implies that they are enslaved. Nobody wants to hear that they are enslaved in any way. Even today, so much of our modern lives tries to reassure us that we are and we should be free from any constraints. Born to be wild. We aspire to self-realization and self-actualization and self-sufficiency. But this passage is not about personal liberties. The principal focus is on freedom from being enslaved to that which separates you from your wholeness, your full humanity, from being enslaved to that which separates you from God. Now, I came to understand this back in the day before I was saved. I had a friend who made a living, let's say, off the grid, participating in the underground economy, but whose dream was to become a poet. Well, his friends, like him, kind of lived off the grid. And he had a best friend, let's call him Eric, whose primary income was selling the favors of women. Now, as I was in college at the time, I was constantly requesting to meet Eric, because I wanted to meet these women and share my newfound knowledge and vocabulary of feminist discourse and patriarchy. Yeah, but that never happened. But this one day, my friend said sadly that he felt the worst part of what his friend Eric was doing and those like him who engaged in this illegal and immoral commerce was that they didn't understand that to engage in that economy, they had to enslave themselves. In the language of our text, they themselves had to become slaves of sin. I will never forget that conversation. He explained to me that to dominate another person that way, to exploit another person that completely, you have to climb into a role as well. So as you take away their humanity, you lose your own. As you exact violence on them, you exact violence on your own spirit and psyche. Now, if you would have said to that man who was doing that he was not free, he would have laughed and said, "I'm free to do whatever I want." Not understanding that his participation in that illegal economy was the result of his denial of freedom in the first place. His denial of freedom to pursue education, his being denied the freedom to be fully engaged in the economic life of this country, was directly connected to his lack of freedom. The lack of freedom of his ancestors who were put on auction blocks, that couldn't walk on the street if a white person was coming down the side of the street, who were hung from trees. I'm sure someone would have said to him, he was not free. He would have said, well, nobody's ever put me out on the straw. I'm as free as I can be. I can make as much money as I want. But Eric was enslaved by the constraints that identified him as being not quite human, perpetually unworthy, and always suspect. And so it wasn't hard for him to demean and exploit somebody else. This story came to my mind as I read the response of the Jewish people in this text. When Jesus says to them, you need to be set free. They understand this in the political realm. We've never been in bondage, they respond. We don't need to be set free. Which is so ironic because if I recall Jewish history, there was that lengthy time of bondage in Egypt. Not only were they in bondage, but their minds were so messed up that it took them 40 years to make a two-week journey. And then, when surveying the land that was promised to them, Canaan, their minds were so bound that they came back and said, the people there are giants. We look like grasshoppers. I think many Americans would have that similar reply to the need to be set free. We're already free. We live in the land of the free and the home of the brave. But Jesus gives a surprising response to this query. What do you mean I will be made free? His answer, if you commit a sin, you are a slave to sin. Just like Eric, who was a slave to enslaving. Just like America, who was a slave to capitalism and racism and notions of manifest destiny. The freedom, they think, to make money by any means necessary, the freedom to incarcerate, the freedom to remove children from their parents, the freedom to enslave, the freedom to exploit, the freedom to detain, the freedom to murder has enslaved this country, has polluted the earth, is poisoning water that children drink, is destroying families. For you cannot enslave others without destroying your own soul. You cannot exploit others without removing a piece of your own humanity. You cannot portray other people as monsters without yourself becoming a monster. We are both slaves and slaveholders at the same time. We allow so many things to enslave us. We live in a society in which power is the political capital of choice, and we are bound, shackled by it, unable to move or think freely. And here Jesus tells us that the way out of this spiritual and psychological incarceration is to know the truth. The truth of who you really are and whose you really are. That's the truth that will set you free. Free from harming others, free from destroying the earth, free from having to sell your soul. The truth that each of us is created in the image and likeness of God. The truth that we are all stewards of the earth. The truth that we are called to be in community and to be our sisters and brothers' keeper. That truth. That there is a force in the universe greater than ourselves. That truth. That is, as Psalm, the 100th Psalm says, know that the Lord himself is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. We are his people, not the people of a political party. We are his people, not the people of a nationalist ideology. We are his people. That truth will set us free. But alas, we are not free from sin. While we celebrate this day, the legal ending of the involuntary servitude of a people, we are not free from the sin of racism that created it. And it has morphed into the prison industrial complex. And that has morphed into the closing of schools, denying free education to those children kissed by the sun and living on the margins. And that has morphed into widespread terror and distrust, even hatred of those who are labeled outsiders. Ironically, by those who stole this land, destroyed the indigenous people of this land, profits from the drug cartels that the people that they're detaining are running from. And so today, we're putting people in concentration camps. The sin of I got mine, I hope you get yours, has given us a tagline of be all you can be. While corporate profits takes jobs overseas to exploit new fields of workers for the lowest wages, while destroying their natural resources. We are all caught in this web of sin. As a country, the sin of exclusivity, the sin of homophobia, the sin of Islamophobia. And as we breathe in the toxic fumes of it, as we feed upon its poisoned flesh, the sin of self-hatred grows inside us as well. How could it not? We are slaves to sin. And like those who fled the slavery of Egypt, when confronted by the struggle of a new reality, lamented the good old days, when at least they knew where their next meal was coming from, where they could lay their heads, accusing Moses that he had only freed them to let them die in the wilderness. Even now, many of in this country are confounded and confused by this alternate reality that says we can be free. Many in this country feel that if freed from racist notions of superiority, they themselves would lose their identity and die in the wilderness of multiculturalism. Many in this country feel that if freed from practices of exploitation, how would they thrive? How would they get ahead? Our sinfulness has put us in bondage, and our bondage is so pervasive. It includes the whole world, I would say even the cosmos. Only when we see how deeply we participate in our own enslavement, only when we see that there is no amount of new life that we can pull up within ourselves to get out of bondage, only then can we let go and hear God's call to a place of renewal, to a great place of freedom. let it all rest on your shoulders alone. You can be free from having to feel the need to hide your failings, your hurts, your neglect, and just walk in the freedom to be. There's something about stepping out of denial that sets us free when you step into the truth of what's going on and who you really are. And once you've taken that step and embraced who Jesus really is, that changes everything. Now, word of caution, setting people free is very unpopular. That's why Jesus says in verse 37, yet you look for an opportunity to kill me because there is no place for you in my world. There is no place for exclusion. There is no place for superiority. There is no place for oppression. But the good news is this, that with that freedom, once you walk into it, once you claim it, once you breathe it in, you have a place in the household, in the family of God. Freedom to be in loving community. The household of God, connecting us to a future that is not yet, but we can see it. Yes. We can imagine it. We can taste it. And even that sets us free right now. This is what Jesus says when he says, the truth will set you free. As a church today, we commemorate Juneteenth. And church, it is not just our job to encourage but to break the bonds that enslave us so that we might live as free souls, that others will see our freedom and say, what must I do to have this freedom that we can all